Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 8th September 2018. News articles we'll be seeing today are these six. Let's see them all in detail. The first article we'll be seeing today is from the perspective of Indian economy. Post Office Solutions, the challenges facing India Post Payment Banks. So this article is with respect to the payment banking system which was brought into India a couple of years back. So the India Post Payment Bank system, it is a financial service provider and it will operate under India's oldest system, that is Postal Department. It is a government owned payment bank and it will be able to accept deposits from the people up to a limit of 1 lakh. But however, it will not be able to provide loans and advances to its customers. Apart from accepting deposits, the Post Payment Bank, it also plans to provide a variety of other financial services to its customers, and it includes postal saving account of about worth 85,000 crore to its people. So the main intention of bringing in this payment banking system in our country is to promote financial inclusion, thereby achieving the government's goal of increasing the people's saving via remittances and other payment financial services, both in rural and unorganized sectors in Indian economy. So this picture talks about the payment banks in India, and it is not only with respect to the postal payment bank, it is generally with respect to the system of payment bank existing in our country. So who can promote this payment bank? So this payment bank can be started by prepaid card issuers, any telecom companies like Airtel, Reliance, etc., non-banking financial companies, business correspondents, supermarket chain, corporates and even rural cooperatives existing in our country. And what they can do, so what in which areas they can operationalize. So the payment banking system, they can have a minimum capital of about 100 crores, and out of which 75% of the deposits must be in the form of the government bonds, and the remaining 25% of the deposits, they can be held in other banks. And if the payment banks, they hold a capital of more than 500 crore, they can get listed in the market. And another condition with respect to payment bank is that about 25% of the bank's operation must be targeted towards unbanked areas, especially in the rural India. And all these payment banks must be fully equipped with the new network and technology driven application, and they cannot accept deposits more than 1 lakh from single individual. So apart from this basic prerequisite, these banks can also sell mutual funds, insurance and other pension schemes, and they can also offer bill payment services for all its customers like electricity bill payment, gas payment, all those bill payments. They can also have ATMs operationalized in different areas, especially in rural areas, and they can function as banking correspondents of another banks also. However, what are the limitations of this payment banking system? These banks, they cannot offer credit card or extend loans to any of its customers, and they cannot also handle cross-border remittances, and they also cannot accept the deposits from non-resident Indians. Apart from financial inclusion, this postal payment bank also has many of other advantages. So we all know that postal system in India is an age-old system, and about there are 1,55,000 post offices operating in all over the country. And this Indian postal payment banking system is hoped to utilize all these post offices in order to provide payment services to the customers present in our country. So this system is expected to utilize all these post offices existing in various parts of the country and provide efficient payment system to its customers. By also utilizing the digital platform, it is expected that this payment system will be more accessible even from remote locations to people in our country. However, not everything is positive with respect to the payment banking system, especially with respect to the postal payment banking system. It does have some limitations. So the biggest challenge with respect to it is whether it will be able to manage and earn profits required in order to survive as a stand-alone business entity, especially when it is facing stiff competition from other public and private banking entities. So this in the light of the new payment banks which came to function last year, for example, Airtel, Paytm, Fino and other private sector bank involved in the business, they cannot be also deemed to be completely profitable. So this post payment banking system, it offers interest rate of about 4% in saving accounts to its customers, And in order to generate revenues, it plans to charge fees on its money transfers and other financial services, while also investing the ideal customers' deposits in other safe government securities. So this is how it will earn its money and give back it in the form of interest rate to its customers. So this whole procedure, its profitability is questionable now. Whether this whole procedure will be sufficient to cover the interest rate of 4% and also cover the other operational cost of the payment banks, and it is questionable now, and one must wait to see how it operates efficiently. However, if it continues to operate in a profitable manner, it will definitely usher a new era of rapid financial inclusion and push India towards a part of economic development in our country. The second article we'll be seeing today is with respect to international relations between India and USA. Recently, the 2+2 dialogue between Indian Defence and External Affairs Ministers and their counterparts from USA was held in India, and it did obtain some significant outcomes, which we'll be seeing in this article. So India-US defense relationship has given significant boost with this meeting. And there were three main areas which were covered upon in this meeting. The first is the agreement COMCASA. We have discussed about this in detail in past several weeks editorial, and we will touch upon that in today's editorial also. So the COMCASA stands for Communication Compatibility and Security Agreement. The second area which was covered in this 2+2 meeting is between defense and foreign ministers of both the countries with respect to their departments. And the third area is with respect to first trilateral service military exercises which will be commenced between both the countries. So this COMCASA is third of four foundational or enabling agreements that is signed between India after more than a decade of negotiation. And this agreement is a consequence of immense defense hardware that has been purchased by India from US in past decade. Apart from this, US is also given a nod to include India in its top tier countries list of entitlement provided to Strategic Trade Authorization, that is STA-1. Other two areas which were touched upon in this meeting includes the area of fighting terrorism, especially in Indo-Pacific region. This is very important in the context of increasing China's role, that is Beijing's role in South China Sea, and the importance given by USA to maintain stability in the Indian Ocean region. And the second perspective is with respect to providing sustainable debt financing in this region. This is also linked to the Beijing's new project of Belt and Road Initiative, which includes chain of countries in Indian Ocean region under the ambit of China. However, while some of the issues of India did get addressed, while some other issues still remain unaddressed. For example, the generalized system of preferences which provides India with special access to technology equipment of United States, its status is still pending. Whether it will be restored or whether waiver will be provided for it is a big question mark which needs to be addressed by the government of United States of America now. Apart from it, the USA officials clearly said that India needs to increase its imports from America, especially in oil and gas, as well as other defense equipments like aircraft, in order to address the trade surplus that India enjoys with respect to USA. And this is a very serious area of concern which India needs to negotiate before entering into any agreement with the United States of America. Another unreasonable demand brought in by United States of America on India is with respect to the issue of Iran. We all know that India is building Chabahar port in Iran, and the new act of USA's parliament, that is USA's Adversaries and Sanctions Act, it includes Iran in its adversaries list. So the question here is, if India goes ahead and has relations with Iran, whether sanctions will be imposed on India? And this question mark also needs to be addressed before any agreement is finalized between India and USA. And the same question mark also arises with respect to Russia, as India is beginning to purchase some missile systems like S-400 from Russia, which may call upon sanctions from America. So as a way forward, Delhi must look and work with Washington for next few months in order to negotiate and secure itself some benefits from the 2+2 dialogue and make it a win-win situation for both the countries. The third article we'll be seeing today is Supreme Court orders Rajasthan to file a report on Alwar lynching case. So we all know the issue of lynching which has been happening in our country in several places in past few months. And especially with respect to states of Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, the number of lynching happened in a couple of months has increased exponentially. And this shows the lack of religious intolerance existing in our country. And it is a direct threat to the fundamental rights of freedom and liberty, which is enshrined in our constitution. So the Supreme Court on Friday, it asked the Rajasthan government to come clean on its investigation on the Alwar lynching case, where the victim Rakhbar Khan, he died of injuries which is alleged due to the lack of functioning of the police machinery in the state of Rajasthan. So the SE condemned this lynching, calling it heinous act of mobocracy by the cow vigilantes. So this issue of cow vigilantes is in news for past couple of months. Another point which is to be noted in this article is that the Rule 3 of Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act and the Rules of 2001, it empowers civil society groups to protect the animals. So it is high time that the state machinery and also the central machinery, it takes serious efforts in order to end this cow vigilantism and takes proactive measures in order to protect the rights of the people in our country. The fourth article we'll be seeing today is Supreme Court refuses to stay the amendments of SCST Act. So the amendments to SCST Act and the various protests because of the Supreme Court judgment was continuously in news for past couple of months, and we have discussed this amendments in detail. Few of the important provisions of the amendments brought in by the Supreme Court, it includes, it has barred the anticipatory bail given to a person accused of insulting or hurting a Dalit. So previously the anticipatory bail cannot be given to a person who has allegedly committed the crime. So this provision of the bill was upturned, and the granting of anticipatory bail was brought in as a new provision by the amendment of the Supreme Court. So this verdict of the Supreme Court, it removed the bar on accused persons seeking for anticipatory bail, and this led to widespread protest and loss of lives in different parts of our country. And this issue was again brought into notice of Supreme Court now, and the Supreme Court on Friday refused to stay the recent amendments on the Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act 1989. So the fifth issue we'll be dealing today is with respect to the Code of Ethics. So the Indian Medical Association, it moots ethics code overhaul. So why do we need ethics in the medical system? For example, can individual doctors advertise, have websites to promote their own practice in order to compete against big cooperative hospitals? So this is a question. Should a donation of cadaver organs be mandatory for everybody? Or is it important for medical students to study ethics throughout their duration of their MBBS course? So all these ethical questions need to be addressed, for which the Indian Medical Association has brought in a new ethics code overall. So this is a huge departure from the existing code of ethics, which is existing from the year 2002 without any changes. This is important especially with respect to India, where about 2.5 lakh students come under the ambit of Indian Medical Association studying medical science in our country. And a redefining code is highly essential in order to ensure a contemporary outlook to the issues which are present in the 21st century. So the code which is to be proposed, it will be submitted to the central ministries, especially health and medical education and justice, and they'll take a call on whether to implement it or not after detailed review. So the new ethics handbook is expected to cover 24 topics, whether including both new issues and other contemporary issues which will be newly brought into code according to the current needs. For example, the current MCI norms, it does not allow doctors to publicize or their practice through any type of advertising. So this issue is considered again, and it may be changed according to the current perspective. And currently the doctors, they cannot give consent to deciding on pulling the plug. That is, it may result to doctor authorized deaths. This decision can be taken only by the relatives, and it also involves serious ethical concerns which is considered now. Another issue which will be covered in this code of ethics is issues involving assisted reproductive technology and surrogacies. So this handbook will include code of procedure for the doctors, how they should ethically ensure the surrogates and egg donors in an efficient way so that they do not get exploited. India carries out a number of high living donor transplant as compared to cadaver organ donation, that is the donations from the dead bodies. So a complete revamp has been expected for a very long, and India is still waiting for this revamp, and it is high time that these reforms are brought in for efficient functioning of ethical medicine system in our country. The sixth issue we'll be dealing today is with respect to FPI start process of falling in line. So there has been a new amendment brought in by SEBI, that is Security and Exchange Board of India, few months back. According to this change, which was brought in April, SEBI barred non-resident Indians and persons of Indian origin from managing their FPI investments in our country. Because of this change, some of the funds have initiated the CRE change of changing the management personnel so that they can come and invest back in India via some other channel. And this change has caused a confusion which needs to be checked in order to avoid FPI inflows and outflow fluctuations in our country. And the committee has been set up and it was extremely receptive to the practical problems arising out of this circular, and it was hopeful that it will find a solution to these problems, especially in the area of FPI in our country. Thank you.